Now, it didn't help that, to be honest, I wasn't completely sure that why I had been invited. My predecessors at the podium, as indicated by the chairman of the Alumni Association, have been renowned academics, world-class researchers, dedicated public servants who have reached the pinnacle of their respective professions. I, on the other hand, am a bit of a failed academic, never having used my doctoral degree in an academic context. And I'm very much a private sector person with what can perhaps be viewed as a somewhat business-oriented focus. I was amused when you were trying to decide whether I was a business person or a lawyer. I have chosen to assume that it's these attributes that may be part of why I have been asked to contribute to this lecture series. And certainly it's these attributes that are informing my remarks today. Perhaps, unfortunately for all of you, this is also a year in which I read a book entitled Year of Yes, written by Shonda Rhimes, who many of you may know is the creator of a television show known as How to Get Away with Murder, and also another one called Scandal. In this book, she essentially makes the argument that everyone must take on a fresh challenge from time to time. I decided this year not only to take on a few things that are outside my comfort zone, but also to try and encourage others, in this case, all of you, to accompany me in doing so. So in the spirit of my year, and since this is a year in which we have seen truly interesting things happening in the world, presumably many of you will have been following the US elections, for example, I've chosen to make use of the uncertainty about why I am this year's speaker to be a little bit of a contrarian. For this reason, my talk may be somewhat atypical for an occasion such as this, less of an erudite lecture than a talk intended to hopefully provoke a conversation in respect of a matter that is totally outside my area of expertise, which, as you know, is either law or business. But it's an area I am very concerned about. As it happens, the area of my concern does fall within the general theme of the Alumni Association this year, which, as you have been told, is governance, education, and ethics. I chose to speak about education because it's a matter that I think is vital, given the substantial bearing it has on the future of you and your children, me and my children, and all Ghanaian children, as well as children in other parts of Africa. And ultimately, it has a bearing on the future of this continent that is our home. I think all of us can agree, given the various events that we've seen in recent times, that this is a matter that does require some conversation. Because I view this as a conversation rather than a typical lecture, the good thing for all of you is that I will probably be speaking for a shorter time than might be usual on these occasions, and deliberately so. I think when one is essentially issuing a call to arms, that call is best delivered in a short but hopefully memorable message. The conversation I would like to provoke builds on this year's theme. Although to some extent it is about education, I feel about the education I feel we should be offering our children, to a greater extent, the conversation I'd like to provoke relates to those of us who are not directly involved in education, who are not educationists, not academics, not teachers, not professors. We are not in the Ministry of Education. We are not in schools, be they professional schools, vocational, secondary, primary. We're not in seminaries. We're not in universities. In other words, we're not educational experts and we're not working in education. And we're asking the question, is there a role those of us who fall into this category should and can play in the education? as I've indicated, education is not really my area of expertise. So I think it's important to explain the context and the perspective that I'm coming from. Partly, this is for the parent. As a parent, I would certainly like to see my children, my nieces, my nephews, their friends and colleagues, employable in any job they want, in any part of this increasingly globalized world. Not because I want our children to leave our shores and work elsewhere, but because I would hate them to be limited in their choices or their opportunities because of some failing or some deficiency in their education. Also, however, and primarily, my perspective is of someone who, to put it metaphorically, consumes the product of a number of African educational institutions. In other words, I also speak as an employer, a private sector employer of the graduates of these African educational institutions. And I'm someone who therefore appreciates the many strengths of our children, but suffers the consequences of their weaknesses. As an employer, I want to employ children, whether graduates or not, who can identify a problem, ask the right questions, think the problem through creatively, assess the information they've generated, and come up with solutions that make sense for the context in which the problem has arisen. At the simplest level, for example, if I have a driver who is happily driving a car that is displaying various warning lights, I think I'm entitled to be worried, particularly if I have occasion to explain what the lights are for, and he continues to drive with no inquiry or concern as to what those lights mean. And let's face it, even today we do have drivers like that. I would not necessarily expect my driver to fix the problem, but I would certainly expect that he should understand that there is a problem and hopefully have a sense of the steps for resolving it. In the same vein, I felt entitled to be outraged many years ago when the technicians employed in installing our first washing machine and dryer in our house in Lagos decided that there was a problem with the dryer because they could not understand how to connect an extractor hose. Just as they were about to hammer a hole in the machine to effect the connection, my steward, who had been watching them with a bit of alarm, stopped them and said he thought he'd better phone his employers because, to quote him, he didn't think the Oyibo man who made the machine would have forgotten that the hose needed to be connected. Obviously, he was right. But more interesting to me was the fact that my steward took the installation manual, and I found him looking through it to try and get a sense for himself of what he thought needed to be done. He wasn't a washing machine technician, but he was thinking through the problem and trying to figure out a solution. In addition to logical, reasoned, and critical thinking, I believe as employers, we should be entitled to expect, indeed to demand excellence in the fundamentals of the education that are given to our children. These fundamentals being, in one view, that of the chairman of the Alumni Association, the three R's, but at least being numeracy and literacy. I'll use literacy, to which I am more accustomed than numeracy, as an example. Because if we're going to educate our children in, say, McCann, our goal must be to get them to excel in writing and in speaking. In order to excel, they should have access to comprehensive grammar books and well-written literature. They should be taught how to communicate current technological and scientific concepts accurately and clearly. The writing of plays, movie scripts, television scripts, poetry, and digital media content in Akan should be encouraged, as should research on that language, the proverbs, the sayings, and so on and so forth. I think it's wonderful that somebody has developed a keyboard that enables the writing of ACAN on digital screens. Definitely something that we require if we were to use ACAN as a language of instruction. Similarly, if we are educating our children in English, I think we should seek to ensure they excel in that language. The English they are taught should be English that enables them to communicate clearly and effectively in whatever discipline they choose, and to do so in a global context. Now, putting this in my specific framework, I believe I'm entitled to expect that the associates I employ in my law firm, no matter which educational institute they graduated from, and some of them were from the University of Ghana, I think I'm entitled to expect that they should be truly literate in English, since as lawyers, English is the language we communicate and work in. Further, I expect that they should understand that beautiful, rich, expressive, and fascinating though it may be, Pidgin English is totally a separate language. I shouldn't expect that a letter or opinion leaving my law firm, especially if it's to an international destination outside Africa where they don't necessarily watch movie magic, should state, for example, that Dr. Bello Osage's father is now late, when what is meant is that Dr. Bello Osage's father is dead or deceased. Taking this further, I feel entitled as an employer to expect that the written English from my lawyers, who have been through, let's remember, primary, secondary, tertiary, and professional education, and who, as I have pointed out, use English as their working language, should be grammatically correct. I can't state the number of times, for example, when I have sent irate messages to members of my firm who write emails or letters stating, "I would see you tomorrow," instead of the obvious "I will," or who say, "She is a staff of some organization or other." I can't help but wonder what on earth people are being taught at primary school and why mistakes such as this are not being corrected by the time they have become professionals. I give these as examples because although I have been forced to accept that some of the rules of grammar or some of the spelling that I knew as a child appear to have changed, indeed some have changed significantly with the increasing use of American English. For example, I can never get used to saying "the data show" as opposed to "the data shows." But anyway, despite these changes, I can't find anyone who accepts that if you definitely intend to do something in the future and there's no conditionality to it, the correct word to use is "I would." My question to my associates or those I'm in a position to communicate with is there a condition to you seeing person tomorrow, or are you waiting for something else to happen before it happens? I don't understand exactly where this comes from. I also feel, as I tell my associates, that as far as I am concerned, a staff is something that shepherds use. Employees are members of staff. I keep wondering as I see these phrases in newspapers and essays and board minutes and speeches written by those who I feel should know better, why, where the phrases came from, why they are so pervasive, and why we continue to accept them so unquestioningly. It may well be that this is the language of the future, but until that is clear and until it is widely accepted, I cannot regard such phraseology as suggestive of excellence. I also kept wondering why certain common words are spelt incorrectly, given the existence of online as well as hard copy dictionaries, but also because of the existence of spell check on computers and phones. Granted, spell check would not pick up certain mistakes, but I can't help but wonder why well-educated people would write the word "dinner" when what is actually meant is "dining." In other words, unless things have changed since my youth, dining is spelled with one N, not two. Why do we see the word baggages on official notices when we know, or at least those of us who are educated in English grammar think we should know, that the plural of baggage is baggage, not baggages, and the plural of equipment is equipment, not equipments? I worry when these mistakes are made by anyone, and I must, for the members of the press who are here, include journalists, because I think they have an immense power to influence the way we write. I must confess that I have been really entertained and very pleased to see some of the social media memes that have come up around things like this. I don't know whether or not this is showing, but this one in particular, somebody sent a message saying, "What did Baumier go to do in the school he bought the furnitures for? Was he there to visit the son or the daughter?" Some of you will recognize this. And the answer that came back, "He went to teach them that the plural for furniture is furniture." Great one. The second one, there's so many, but I've limited myself to two. There's a picture of a lady, and the question she's asking is, "If I get pregnant, will I give birth to a male or a female? Male spelled M-A-I-L and female spelled F-E-M-A-I-L. And the response was, "You will give birth to a post office." I thought it was a great new world response to what is clearly an old world problem. Indeed, it was because I was so furious about a misspelling that I embarked on my initial journey into school governance as a member of a primary school board in Nigeria. Like many working mothers, I was rarely home when my children got back from school, but I did make an effort to ensure I checked my children's homework each evening before they left for school in the morning. On this particular occasion, I remember correcting a misspelt word, tomatoes, spelt T-O-M-A-T-O-S, rather than what I thought was correct, T-O-M-A-T-O-E-S. The next evening, I noted that my daughter's class teacher had marked the corrected word as incorrect. And of course, my daughter was extremely upset because I had not only, in her view, ruined her perfect score, I had also caused her class teacher to be annoyed with her. I asked her if she had told her class teacher that her mother had corrected her homework. She confirmed that she had. I asked her if her class teacher had asked why her mother had made the change. She informed me that she hadn't. I asked her if she had ever seen the word written that way in any of the books that she had read or I had read to her. She agreed that she hadn't. I asked if she knew whether or not her class teacher had checked the dictionary before marking the corrected word as incorrect. Obviously, she could not say. But I'm sure you can guess the rest of the story. I charged off to school and asked the teacher to explain to me why the word had been corrected. She said it was wrong. I asked her whether or not there was a Nigerian dictionary that the school was required to use, which specified that spelling, because as I explained, I checked an English dictionary, I checked an American dictionary, and in neither of these was the word spelt the way she spelt it. To put it mildly, she was upset. I took the matter to the headmistress, who acknowledged that I was right, but as I subsequently pointed out to the class teacher, my irritation was not so much because she felt I was wrong. I definitely am not an expert in English grammar, and my spelling might well have been incorrect. But rather, my irritation was because I felt that if a parent had corrected a word, the sensible thing for an intelligent class teacher to do was to check before marking it incorrect. She had the ability to do so. What kind of a lesson, I wondered, was she teaching my child? What kind of a teacher was so incurious? And I did check, that is a word. So incurious that she would not make sure she was right. The result of all this was I found myself invited to join the school board, and I accepted. I still remain on the board, by the way, almost 30 years later. Having had many conversations on issues such as this over the years, I know I'm not the only person who is frustrated and sometimes alarmed by what I have to term these deficiencies of excellence, several of which sometimes carry over into the way professions and vocations are practiced. There's sometimes a lack of curiosity, a lack of logical inquiry, a failure to adopt a mathematical or scientific or logical approach to a specific issue, problem, or project. Who amongst us is not frustrated by buildings and stairs that are crooked, obviously crooked, and we have to listen to a builder, or sometimes even more upsetting, an architect, tell us that we should accept the deficiency, that we should, in other words, manage. Aren't spirit levels and tape measures and rulers part of the standard kit for these professions? Who amongst us has not had occasion to be concerned by a doctor who does not seem either to be very up to date about a particular issue or even aware of it, when we, the lay people, have read about it in an everyday newspaper, not a scientific journal? I include examples, for example, of nurses who don't seem to be very concerned about health and hygiene because they do not wash their hands. I'm sure, like me, you know people who have gone outside to have surgical procedures because although they accept that the surgeon is good, they're not sure they will survive the nursing. Now, who is not upset by the fact that sometimes when we have x-rays or scans taken, we can't read the results because whoever took them in the first place did not do so properly? I'm also upset, I have to add, by the fact that despite the excellent town planning and urban planning departments that we have in a couple of our educational institutions, I think parts of our country are being destroyed by overbuilding or by the fact that an absence of planning or the failure to enforce that planning are compromising our ability to design cities for the future. We need aesthetically pleasing cities and towns, and cities that incorporate good infrastructure and environmental awareness. Rather, and despite seeing what is wrong elsewhere and seeing what the possibilities of doing better are, we appear sometimes to be building concrete jungles or what are pretty much slums. Now, clearly there are other reasons why people do not work or practice their professions to internationally acceptable standards. And certainly they don't seem to want to excel at them. And greed and corruption are two obvious ones. But in certain instances, I do feel one may have to ask if perhaps part of the reason for these failures is a lack of education, or perhaps more accurately, the lack of a certain kind of education. I think it perhaps is necessary for me to explain how I'm using the word education, since it can be used in such a large number of ways and can mean different things in different contexts. True education is defined as the process of developing the ability to learn, to apply, to unlearn, and relearn. And broadly speaking, such education can be required pretty much anywhere during our journey from the cradle to the grave. As may be clear from everything I've said so far, however, although I certainly have true education in mind, I'm speaking to the particular and somewhat narrow description of education, which is the description of education as a process of receiving or giving systematic instruction, especially at a university or a school. That process is one which imparts knowledge, and obviously the ideal situation is where that knowledge is useful, assuming of course that there could ever be knowledge that is not useful. For purposes of this conversation, the education that I'm concerned about, or the education I'd like to see, is education that imparts knowledge, but is also purposeful, in that it seeks to achieve or to support the achievement of a particular goal or objective. I suggest that if our ultimate goal is to better the lives of Ghanaians through economic development, as ought to be the case, the knowledge emanating from or generated by our educational institutions must be education that not only responds to the social, political, and economic context of our country, but also takes cognizance of what the future of our country ought to look like. If nothing else, we have to ensure that the education we provide at the most basic level is education that works to improve our GDP, works to improve our ranking on the Human Development Index, and works to reduce the corruption that so unfortunately impedes our efforts to achieve the objectives of substantial economic growth. As far as I'm concerned, the education that our educational institutions must provide at this time in the history of our country